Hello and welcome to STQB Foundation Level Syllabus. And here we are going to continue with chapter number 1, that is Fundamentals of Testing. So until now we covered what is testing, why is testing necessary, and in the last lecture we covered 7 testing principles. Now in this lecture we are going to cover the test process. This is also one of the important topics. It's a very big topic. But you are going to get only one question from this part. So it has 4 subtopics. First, you need to know the context of the test process. So test process is context dependent, and how they are context dependent, that is what we are going to see here. Then we have to describe the test activities and respective tasks within the test process. So test process is a big term. Inside test process, we have test activities, and each test activities we have different tasks, and that is what we have to see in this chapter. The third topic is differentiate the work product that supports the test process. So as I said, test process is a big activity. Inside that we have test activities. When we perform test activities, there are certain tasks. So once we complete our task, what we will get? We will get the output. So we need to know for which test process, what is the output? That is what we are going to see in chapter in the third topic. And the last topic is explain the value of maintaining traceability between the test basis and test work product. So why we should make the traceability? So this traceability concept we will understand in detail in the last topic. So these are the 4 topics which we are going to cover under test process. So before we start, what we should know is the overview of the test process. So what is a test process? A test process is the set of interrelated activities. It is a set of interrelated activities. What are the activities first we need to know? It comprises of test planning, test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, and test completion. All these things together constitutes test process. Therefore, we say a test process is a set of interrelated activities comprising of test planning, monitoring and control, analysis, design, implementation, execution, and completion. So what you need to remember is it is an interrelated activities. Next. Why we need this test process? What is the need of test process? So in an organization, there are different peoples with different roles assigned to them. For an example, we have business analyst, we have technical analyst, we have testers, we have business representatives, we have business sponsors, automation specialist, and many more roles. Now, for them to work in a synchronized way, and so that they know that what will happen first, what will happen second, what will happen third, they know this clearly to avoid any type of miscommunication in between within the team. We need test process. So this is all about test process. Now what we need to know is, before we proceed further, what are the keywords which we are going to cover under this topic. So starting, we saw these are the different keywords which we should cover in chapter number 1. Out of this, the majority of the keywords will be covered now under this topic, like test analysis. You will understand what is the meaning of test analysis, test basis, test cases, test completion, test condition, test control, test data, test design, test execution, implementation, monitoring, test object, objective of test. Then test oracle, planning, procedures, process, test suites. So all these things you should know, and you should know the difference between them. That should be our approach when we complete this topic. And there are 2 more, testware and traceability. So whenever we come across these words, please pay more attention. So here I have listed down few keywords which are very important Before we proceed further, or if you want to understand the complete topic, the topic number 4, we need to understand these terms properly and the difference between them. The first term is test basis. The body of knowledge used as the basis for test analysis and design. It is a body of knowledge. And why it is used? It is used for analysis and design purpose. In a very simple term, what you can say is requirement is nothing but the test basis. The requirement document which you get is a test basis. But in ISTQB syllabus, they have used the term test basis. So based on this, we perform our testing. That's why the name test basis. The body of knowledge used as the basis for test analysis and design. Let's understand this. This is a very important term. All these terms are very important. So we have to understand these terms. Suppose this is the requirement, that means test basis. We got it from the customer. We need a light system which will glow when door is open and close when door is closed. So light will glow when the door is open, light will switch off when the door is closed. The system shall work like mentioned. After reading this requirement, what we need to do is we have to find out, so we are analyzing the requirement now. This is the test basis. We have to find out the test conditions. First, we got the test basis. Based on this, we have to perform testing. Now, test condition. A testable aspect of a component or system identified as a basis for testing. Here, what we are doing? We are identifying the testable aspect of the requirement. So as I have given you this example, this was the test basis where everything is there. Now we have to find out what are the test conditions, what all things we can test in it. So these are the two things which we can test. For example, light shall glow when door is open, light shall not glow when door is closed. So this is the point or this is the part which is relevant for the testing purpose. So this is what we have to extract from the main document or from the test basis. Once we have the test condition, the next step is the test cases. What are the test cases? A set of preconditions, inputs, actions, expected results, and post conditions developed based on test condition. This is important, based on test condition. So we have a test condition. By looking into the test condition, what we need to do is we have to write down the test cases. So this is a test design where we have two test cases. So based on these two conditions, we are writing two test cases. First one, switch on power because we need a battery to turn these things on. Then open the door and then check that the light is on and then switch off the power supply. So here this is the precondition. This is the action which we are taking and this is the post condition. Once your work is done, you should switch off the power supply. And the second condition is similar to that. Then again switch on the power supply, close the door, check that the lights are off now, and then switch off the power supply. So these are the two test cases which we derived from the test condition. And the test conditions are derived from the test basis. So this is the main document on which testing depends on. I hope now the points are clear. Now the next point is test procedure. A sequence of test cases in execution order. So we have the test cases, but we have to keep them in an order so that we can execute them. We will see what is the meaning of that. A sequence of test cases in execution order and any associated actions that may be required to set up the initial precondition and any wrap-up activities post-condition. What they are trying to say is that first of all, we will have lots of test cases when we are analyzing the test conditions. Then these test cases, we have to arrange them in an order so that we can execute them. In that, we also have to see that once the first test case is done, can we run the second test case or not? Or do we need to take care of certain things in between? So there are certain parameters which we disable before we start running the next test cases so that there is no influence of test case 1 on test case 2. We want to avoid the influence of test case 1 on test case 2, and that is what we take care here. Initial preconditions and any wrap-up post-execution thing. Okay. Now comes test data. Data needed for test execution. So when we want to execute the test cases, so normally execution is the term which is used for the automation testing. So let's see what is the meaning of test data. So we have power supply here, right? Switch on power supply, but we didn't tell how much power we have to give. So it is 12 volt. Then door status. So when we will consider the door is open, when we will consider the door is closed. So when 0 we give, that means door is off. When we give 1, that means the door is on. So these are the data which we need to feed to the test cases so that it can execute automatically. So this is all about test data. Data needed for test execution. So all the data which you need for your execution are referred as test data. Then what is test suites? A set of test scripts or test procedures to be executed in a specific order or in a specific test run. So test suites are like this. You can have multiple test cases, like you can have test case 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like until 11. But then in a test suite, what you do is you group them. So once you execute the first test suite, that is the set 1, only test case 2, 4 and 11 will be executed. Similarly, when you select the second test suite, then test case 1, 3 and 7 will execute. So you are grouping the test cases in some order. That is called test suites. What is testware? So whatever output you get from the testing environment, when you are doing testing, whatever you give as an output are referred as testware. For example, test cases, test conditions, results, test environment, everything comes under testware. So work products produced during the test process for use in planning, design, execution, evaluation and reporting on testing. So any document which we produce or which we get during the testing phase are referred as testwares. Now the very important term, that is test oracle. I have seen a lot of questions based on this. So let's see what is the meaning of test oracle. A source to determine an expected result, to compare with the actual result for the system under test. So during testing, what we do? We measure the result, we get the result, we compare it with the expected result. So this expected result we have to store somewhere. That place is called test oracle. Test oracle is a source to determine an expected result so that we can compare that with the actual result. So I hope now it is clear what is test oracle. It is just a storage place where we store the expected result. With this, we covered all the topics. Let's summarize them one by one quickly. So the first term which we saw is test basis. It is the body of knowledge used as the basis for test analysis and design. In a simple term, test basis is nothing but the requirement. Second, test condition is defined as a testable aspect of a component or system identified as a basis for testing. Next, test case is defined as a set of preconditions, inputs, actions, expected results, and pre-post conditions developed based on test conditions. So test cases we develop based on test condition. Test conditions we get from the test basis. Next, test procedure. Test procedure is a sequence of test cases in execution order and any associated actions that may be required to set up the initial preconditions and any wrap-up activities post-execution. Next, test suite is defined as a set of test scripts or test procedures to be executed in a specific test run. So here we are grouping the test cases. During test suites, what we do, we group the test cases or test scripts and test procedures. Test data is defined as data needed for test execution. So whatever data we need for the execution are referred as test data. Testware. is defined as work product produced during the test process. So whatever work product, whatever output you produce during the test process, for example, during the planning stage, design stage, execution stage, evaluation stage, reporting stage, whatever data you produce are referred as testware. Test oracle, a source to determine an expected result to compare with the actual result of the system under stage, under test. Test oracle is a storage, it is a place where we store the expected results. So I hope all these points are clear. You can pause the video and go through these points. They are very important for the upcoming lecture. Next, test process context. So this is the first topic which we need to now understand under test process. So until now, whatever we saw is the overview so that we can understand these topics. Okay. So here we have to explain the impact of context on the test process. So we have test process, and what are the different factors that can influence test process, or what are the different context which can influence the test process, that is what we need to understand here. First of all, there is an ISO standard in which test process is defined or explained. ISO, IEC, IEEE 29-1192. This is a ISO standard in which the test process is explained in detail. For the exam point of view, you don't have to remember, but we will not take any chance. So at the end, what I will do is I will provide you the list of all the ISOs which we are going to cover in chapter number 1. Okay. So for time being, just remember 29-1192 is a standard in which test processes are defined. Let's move further. So contextual factors that influences the test procedure for an organization are, so when you introduce a test process in an organization, there are some context related factors which will influence them or influence it. They are software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. So what type of software model you are using, that will influence the test process which you are going to follow or which you are going to select. Test levels and test types being considered. So at what level of testing you are doing, or what type of testing you are doing, that will also influence the test process. Product and project risk. What is the risk associated with your project? That will also influence your test process. Business domain. In which type of business you are in, that will also influence the test process. Operational constraints. So for operating a project within an organization, what are the different factors which will influence the test process? That is what we will see here. And then organizational policies and practices. So what are the policies which your organization is following or which you have to follow, that will also influence the test process. And last one, required internal and external standards. So what are the standards which we should fulfill for our product, that will also influence the test process. So these are the different factors which will affect the selection of test process. Now we will see them in detail, each of these steps, each of these context in detail. So the first context is software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. So what type of software development lifecycle model we are using? For example, when we use V model, that time we go for the incremental process. Whereas when we follow agile model, we go for the iterative process. We will cover this topic in more detail in the second chapter, but just as an overview, let's have a look. So when I talk about software development lifecycle model, that is about V model. So this is how a V model looks like. So here we do testing once the first stage is completed, and we perform testing in a parallel way. What does this mean? We will cover in chapter number 2, as I said, but for time being, this is the V model. And if we select this model, the way we test will change compared to the agile model. Agile model is a more iterative model. Every week you have to perform testing. So you have to select a process which will fulfill that, which will be a complementary to what you want to do in your agile development model. So this is a V model, this is an agile model. Okay, and if you select any of this model, your test process, the way you approach or the way or the test process you select will be different. So this is the first point, software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. Next one, test levels and test types being considered. When we say test levels, again, all the test levels and test types we will cover in chapter number 2. We will just see the overview over here. So if you are at the component level or integration testing level or system testing level or at acceptance testing level, at each of this level, the way you test will change, and based on that you have to select the test process. Similarly, when you do different type of testing, for example, when you perform functional testing or you perform non-functional testing, white box testing, change related testing, your approach is different. That's why we say test level and test type being considered influences the test process. Next factor, product and project risk. Suppose you are working for an automotive industry, or if you are working for an avionic industry, obviously the risk over here is big. If something fails here, then it will cost life of a lot of people. Whereas if something fails in the car, then also it's a threat to the life, but the impact is comparatively less. So based on what product we are using, we have to select the test process. Here the testing is going to be more rigorous compared to the automotive project. So remember, product and project risk influences the test process. Next, business domain. This is quite simple. Suppose you are working for an e-commerce. So here, the software which you will build for the billing purposes, it should be in a position to handle different load conditions, right? Whereas when you are working for the security related product, then the objective is to see that the software is secure enough or not. And since the objective is different, to achieve this objective, we will have a different type of test process. So business domain also influences the test process. Next one, operational constraints. So when you are working in an organization, there are certain constraints. For example, budget and resources. If you don't have enough budget, then you cannot repeat the testing cycle again and again. Time scale. If the duration is less, that time also you cannot perform multiple testing cycles. If the code is, or if the product is very complex, the technology is new, then you may not know what all type of testing you should perform on it. Then you may have to go for different type of approach. Then contractual and regulatory requirements. So what contract you signed when you got this project, based on that also you have to change your test process. So operational constraints are budget and resources, time scale, complexity, contract and regulatory requirements. Next, organizational policies and practices. Okay, so we already saw the development model in your organization, what type of development model they are using. Based on that, the test process will change, and what type of strategy they are doing, like test planning, which type of test techniques they are using, which type of tools they are using, that will also influence that test process which you are going to follow. So organizational policies and practices. The last one, required internal and external standards. So there are two standards, like ISO 26262, that is for the automotive industry. Here the main concern is about the safety, whereas ASPICE is also an automotive standard. Here we focus on the process related stuff. So based on what type of standard you have in your organization, the test process will change. So let's summarize all the context which we saw till now. The first one is software development lifecycle model and project methodologies being used. Test levels and test types being considered. Product and project risk. Business domains. Operational constraints like business budget and resources, time scale, complexity, contractual and regulatory requirements, organizational policies and practices, required internal and external standards. So these are some of the factors or context based on which we have to select the test process. Now, we have to see in an organization how the test process is implemented. What are the different part in it? So there is three general aspects. The first one is test activity and task. So under test process, what are we going to have? We are going to have a test activity. Under this test activity, we will have different tasks. When we perform this task, we will get the output. That output is referred as test work product. Once we have different work products, we have to provide the traceability between them so that we know that this work product belongs to which test process. Okay, so there are three general aspects. First one is test activity and task, test work product, and traceability. Let's understand that in more detail. So this is a general aspect of organizational test process. Okay, we have generalized the test process here, but based on the organization, based on the context, it can change, it may change. So now the first one, what we saw is that the activities. So these are the activities which are listed down here. There are 7 activities. You have to remember them in the same order it is listed, because in the exam they may ask you the correct order. So first one is test planning. Then comes test monitoring and control, test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, test completion. So these are the different activities. When we say test planning, inside test planning there will be different tasks which we will see in the upcoming lecture. Similarly, when we say the analysis test, there are different tasks which we are going to do. When we perform the task under these activities, what we get is we get the output, and the output is referred as work product. For an example, when you are in the planning stage, whatever activity you do at the end, what you will get? You will get the test plan. Similarly, when you are monitoring and controlling, what you will get? You will get the test progress report. So that is the output of this stage. When you are in the analysis stage, that time you will get the prioritized test conditions. When you are in the design stage, you will get the test cases. When you are in the implementation stage, you will get test suites. When you are in the execution stage, the output is defect report. And when you complete your task, then you will have a finalized testware. As I said, testware means output of each stage. So finally, we will summarize all the outputs, or we will collect all the outputs. I hope till now it is clear. Under test process, we have test activities. Under test activities, we have different tasks. These are the different test activities. Inside each activity, we have different tasks. When we perform these tasks, we get the output. The output is referred as work product. Now what we need to do is, these work products are individual. We should know which test case belongs to which test condition. For that reason, we have the traceability. Let's first understand what is traceability, and then we will see the definition over here. So now we are going to see the traceability concept. Suppose you have the requirement from the customer. Okay, requirement 1, 2, 3, 4. Likewise, you can have n number of requirements, like 1000, 2000, 10,000 requirements you may get from the customer. Then, based on this requirement, after analysis, after finding the test condition, what you are going to do is, you are going to write the test cases. So let's say the number is test case 1, test case 2, test case 3, test case 4. Likewise, until n number of test cases you can have. Now, the question comes, how you will come to know which test case belongs to which requirement? For that reason, we need the traceability. It is not necessary that test case 1 belongs to requirement 1 only. We can have a jumbled up test cases here. For example, test case 2 belongs to test case, requirement 2 belongs to test case number 4. Requirement 3 belongs to the last test case. Likewise, we can have multiple links. So these are the virtual links. Once you click on the test case, you can see that it is referred to which requirement. Similarly, when you click on the requirement, you will see that it is covered by which test case. It is a bi-directional link. So this is the concept of traceability. Once you have the output, you should know that the output belongs to which test case. And that is what is written over here. Traceability is to maintain traceability throughout the test processes between each element of the test basis. Each element of the test basis means each element of the requirement and the various test work product, between the requirement and the work product associated with that element. So we have requirement, we have different output, we have to link it to the requirements, and for that we need the traceability concept. We will cover traceability concept in more detail in the fourth subtopic. So what you need to now know is, as we have already seen, the test process is defined under 29.119.2 standard, whereas test work product is defined under 29.119.3 standard. First we'll have a test process. Once we perform the task, then only we will get the work product. So that's why you can remember 2 is less, 3 is more, means 3 should come afterwards. So once we perform the test process, then only we will get the work product. So that way also you can remember it, whether 2 belongs to test process or 3 belongs to test process. Okay, 3 belongs to the test work product because it is the output of the test process. So it will come in the later stage. This is just for remembering purpose. Okay, I don't know why this number like this, but just to remember, this is the concept which we can follow. 29.119.2 is for test process. 29.119.3 is for the test work product. Moving further, let's summarize all the points which we saw till now. So there are 3 aspects of organization and test process. Those are test activity and task, test work product, and traceability. And then 29.119.2 is for test process. 29.119.3 is for test work product. Now what are we going to see is the first test activity. The first activity is test planning. So you need to understand here what is the meaning of test planning. Again, this topic is covered in more detail in chapter number 5. So here we are just going to see the overview of it. So as we know, test planning is the first activity of test process. And here we have 3 main activities. So under test planning, task, we have 3 main tasks. Defining the test objective, we have to define the objective of our testing. Defining the test approach and updating the test plan based on feedback. Let's understand all these 3 points in detail. First is defining the test objective. So during planning, we have to ask question like what to test, how to test, and when to test. Defining the objective. So in the test planning, we will have a complete roadmap. What we are going to test, how are we going to test, and when we are going to test these things. All these details will be there in the test planning. Next one is, so this is the test plan which I already explained. Next is defining the test approach. It also includes approach from meeting the test objective within the constraints imposed by the context. So if you remember, initially we saw these are the different objectives. So this is what we have to achieve when based on the context, we have to select the test approach. Okay, so these are the context or the objective. Based on the context, what we have to do is we have to define the test approach. In which product we want to test, based on that product, we should change our approach or we should select our approach. Next one, updating plan based on the feedback. So testing is not a one-time activity. It's not like that in the starting of the project you did planning once and then that is all, that is enough. It's not like that. We need feedback, because while working it is possible that we may deviate from actual plan. Deviate means whatever is planned, we are not as per the plan. We are deviating from it, from the actual plan. That's why we need feedback mechanism to monitor the progress. So what it means is, so this is a test plan. What we did is we are telling when the test will start, when the design activity will start, when the implementation activity will start, when it will end, and when the software will release. But during this time, if we see that whatever test cases we wanted to build, we could not build it, we are behind the schedule, then that feedback will go to the monitoring stage, and then monitoring stage will update the planning stage, and then we have to update our planning. We can include more resources, we can increase the timeline, anything, there are many factors, but that input should go to the planning stage. Okay, that is the reason we say we have to update the plan based on the feedback. So these are the three main important points which we need to consider during planning stage. So I can summarize the points now. The three main tasks of test planning are defining the test objective, defining the test approach, and updating the plan based on the feedback. This is all about the planning stage. Now we will move to the test monitoring and control stage. So this is the second stage in the test process. The first stage is test planning, and the second stage is test monitoring and control. We need to understand why test monitoring is necessary. First of all, why we need this stage? So let's understand the overview. So we know that test plan is a point where we define the, or where we have a roadmap for the upcoming activities. We say that when the test will start, when the analysis will start, and when the test will finish, and we will release the software to the customer. But during execution, we see that there is some problem in the test environment and we are not able to correct it on time. Then what we need to do is, to find such effects, the monitoring stage comes into picture. At each stage, we will have a monitoring mechanism like this. At each stage, we will be monitoring, and we will see that whatever we planned for this state, are we able to achieve that or not? If not, then from the monitoring stage, we will have a two-way communication, and we will communicate to the test planning stage. And that is why the monitoring stage is required, so that if we are deviating from the plan, we can update the planning sheet. Now the question comes, what is test monitoring and control? Is it same? Monitoring means and control means same, and how they are different? Monitoring means what and control means what? So when we say test monitoring, what we actually doing here is, it involves the ongoing comparison of actual progress against planned progress using any test monitoring metrics defined in the test plan. So during monitoring, what we do is, we compare the actual progress of that stage with the planned progress. During planning, we will tell that, okay, within a week, we should have 100 test cases run. But if we see that in the first day or second day, we only executed 10 test cases, that means we are behind the schedule. In 2 days, if we are testing only 10 feature, how can we test 100 test cases in 5 days? Not possible. So this is what the monitoring will do. It will do the actual progress. It will compare the actual progress with the planned progress. This is what we do in the monitoring stage. Next is test control. What we do here is, it involves taking necessary actions to meet the objective of the plan. For an example, I gave you, during the execution stage, we wanted to run 100 test cases, but in 2 days we ran only 10 test cases. So now as an action, as a control, what we need to do is, we can deploy more resources, more people to the project, so that they can execute and we can speed up the thing. or we can find out what is the problem, try to correct that so that it can be finished on time, or we can increase the deadline. Any of the things we can do, but those are the control activities. Control activity will come into picture only when there is a deviation between the actual progress and the planned progress. So then what is the meaning of test monitoring and control? Are supported by the evaluation of exit criteria. Exit criteria means, as we said, 100 test cases. In 5 days, we have to complete 100 test cases. That is the exit criteria. That is the target, which are referred to as the definition of done in some software development lifecycle model. So this exit criteria is referred as definition of done. Definition of done means in 5 days, if you complete 100 test cases, that means you have achieved what we wanted in the planning stage. And that is what test monitoring and control try to do. I hope you understood what is test monitoring, what is test control, and how they are different. Now we talked about the exit criteria, right? In the previous slide, I told exit criteria means what we should achieve, the target. So we have to evaluate the exit criteria during this stage. How we can evaluate the exit criteria? By checking the test result and log against the specified coverage criteria. So initially we will specify like 100% requirement should cover. Then we have to check whether 100% requirement is covered or not. That is the evaluation against the exit criteria. Next point is assessing the level of component or system quality based on the test result and logs. So we can say that once the testing is done, we should have only 10 open defects. Okay, once the testing is done, we should have only 10 open defects. If we have more than 10 open defects, that means the quality is bad. So this is one metric. So we have to assess the quality of the software based on the result. And next one is determining if more tests are needed. So we will see, we have planned, okay, 10 test cases we will execute. But we have to see that during the planning stage, is 10 test cases enough? If we are finding more bugs, then can we write more test cases to test this feature? So not only restricting to what we have planned, but to see that whether we can add something to the planning or not. For that also, we have to evaluate the product or monitor the product. So evaluation of criteria includes checking, assessing, and determining. And why we want to do monitoring stages, the important factor is communication to the stakeholder. We will have all the data, what we wanted, what we achieved. By having this data, we can communicate with the stakeholders. Test progress against the plan. What we planned and how much we have achieved. That we can communicate to the stakeholder. Next, deviations from the plan. Whatever we plan, like 100 test cases we plan and we only completed 90 test cases. So this deviation we can record. Next, information to support any decision to stop testing. If the software is not working fine in the first day itself, we can say that the software is unstable and we cannot test it. So such type of decision we can take if we are monitoring it continuously. And then we can communicate it to the corresponding stakeholders. It could be manager or the customer or the lead, anyone. We can communicate the status to them. For that, monitoring is very much required. So this is all about test control and monitoring stage or monitoring and control stage. We will learn more about it in the fifth chapter. But as of now, what we will do is we will summarize all the points which we saw till now. First point is, test monitoring involves the ongoing comparison of actual progress against planned progress using any test monitoring matrices defined in the test plan. Okay, so some matrices we have defined in the test plan. Based on that, we do the comparison. Test control involves taking necessary actions or actions necessary to meet the objective of the test plan. So whatever we plan during the planning stage, whether we have to achieve that, and for that we can perform some necessary actions, and that is called the test control activity. Test monitoring and control are supported by the evaluation of exit criteria, which are referred to as the definition of done in some software development lifecycle model. Evaluation of exit criteria includes assessing and determining the test activities. Main activities of test monitoring and control are, so there are some main activities. First of all, to check the test result and log against specified coverage criteria. The level of component of system quality based on the test results and logs. To determine if more tests are needed to gain the confidence. And to inform the stakeholders about test progress against the plan, any deviation from the plan, or any information to support and any decision to stop testing. So these are the different points which comes from the test monitoring and control stage. So you can pause the video and just go through it twice and thrice so that this topic is done for you. Now what we are going to do is we are going to the next stage, that is test activities definition. So until now we covered two activities. Now we will see the remaining activities, but before going to the remaining activities, because they all are interrelated, we will see their definition so that we can understand the topic properly. So in the previous session, we covered impact of context on the test process. This is what we have seen. Now what we are continuing with is test activities and respective tasks within the test process. So we have to see the test activity and we have to see what are the tasks we perform under that. So till now we covered test planning and test monitoring. Now we are going to see test analysis, test design, test implementation, test execution, and test completion processes. For that we need to understand the meaning. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed. During the analysis stage, what we are doing? We are analyzing the test basis. Test basis means requirement. So we are analyzing the requirement. Why? To identify testable features and identify associated test conditions. We analyze the requirement so that we identify the testable feature and the associated test conditions. We already saw the example of it. So when we are at the test analysis stage, what we need to do is we have to ask question what we should test, what to test. This is a question which you should ask during the test analysis stage. What I mean by that is, here the first thing is test basis is analyzed, that you should know that requirement is analyzed during this stage. So this is the requirement which we got. It is the same requirement which we discussed previously. We need a light system which will glow when door is open and close when the door is closed. The system shall work like mentioned. So this is what we have to analyze. After analyzing, what we need to do, we have to identify the testable feature. So out of this, the last line is of no use, and then we can have a testable feature like this. Light shall glow when door is open and close when door is closed. So this is the testable feature that we have identified. After that, what we have to do is we have to identify the test conditions. So inside this, we have two test conditions. Light shall glow when door is open. Light shall not glow when door is closed. So these are the test conditions which we get after analyzing the requirement, that is test basis. So remember this point. During test analysis, you ask question what to test, and there we see, we analyze the requirement, we identify the testable feature, and then finally we define the test conditions. Next, test analysis. So this is what we saw, the definition. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed to identify testable feature and define associated test conditions. I am repeating it again and again so that you by heart hear itself. The next definition is test design. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into. So here what we are doing during test design, we are getting test condition as an input. For test design stage, test condition is the input. And in this stage, we are elaborating it. We are expanding it further to a high level test cases. Now we are writing a high level test cases or set of high level test cases or other test ways. So that means during test design, we write the high level test cases from where? From the test condition. Let's see them. So during test design, we should ask how to test. So previously we asked what to test. Now we have to ask a question, how to test. So we have a test condition. So how we can test it? That is what we will answer in the test design stage. The test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases. What we are doing here is we are elaborating the test conditions into high level test cases. So until now we saw in the previous stage, that is the analysis stage, we got the test condition from the test basis. In this stage, what we do is we write the test design. During that, for these two test conditions, we wrote the two test cases. Then identification of defect in the test basis. So when you read the test condition, if you find any defect in it, you have to report it. So identification of defect in the test basis. So finding the defect in the test basis happens in the design stage. Please remember this point. We do two things. First one is the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases or set of high level test cases. And other than that, we also identify the defect in the test basis. This is very important. So this is the test design definition. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases and set of high level test cases. Moving to the next test activity, that is test implementation. So what we do here is, during test implementation, the test wears, that means the output necessary for test execution is created. So whatever we need for the test execution, we create all those things during the test implementation stage. So this concept you have to remember. Whatever we need to execute the test cases are implemented or prepared during the test implementation stage. Execution is created or completed, including sequencing the test cases into test procedure. So what at the end you need to know is, during test implementation, we have to make everything ready so that during test execution, we can just execute the test cases. Let's understand it in more detail. Test implementation. So here we have to ask a very important question. Do we have everything now to test? So next stage is a execution stage where the actual testing will take place. So we should ensure that during the implementation stage that we have everything to test. We have to see that the test waste necessary for the test execution is created or completed. So for our requirement, we need a computer, we need a software, we need a switch to switch on and switch off, we need a power supply, we need a battery, we need a door or miniature version of the door or simulation of the door and the light. All these things should be ready. The test environment should be ready during the test implementation stage. Next, sequencing the test cases into test procedure. So you know that in the previous stage we wrote the test case, yes, in the design stage. In this stage, we have to divide it into low level test cases. What does that mean? First of all, we have to sequence them, like we have to arrange them in order in which we want them to execute. So during execution, we just want to execute. So the arrangement, we have to do it in the test implementation stage. Similarly, for the test scripts also, we can write the test scripts during test implementation stage. So these are the things which we do in the implementation stage. So what you need to remember is, during test implementation, we make everything ready which is necessary for the execution stage. That is the main purpose over here. Next one, test execution. This is the stage where we are executing the test cases. During test execution, test suits are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. So test suits are created during the test implementation stage, and we will just use this suit and run it, and that will be referred as test execution stage. So let's have a look into it. So during test execution, what we do is we check whether we have run all the test cases or not, because that is what we have to do in this stage. Test suits are run, so all the test cases will be run in the same order in which they were arranged during the test implementation stage. Compare and evaluate the result. So once you execute the test case, what you will get? You will get the measured result. Then that measured result you will compare with the expected result. And if both are same, the test case will pass. If there is a deviation, then the test case will fail. So this is what you need to do. You have to run all the test suits, and then you have to compare and evaluate the results during the test execution stage. And you have to ask question, are all tests run? So during test execution, test suits are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. Test completion. This is the last stage, seventh step. Test completion activities collect data from completed test activities. So all the activities which we completed previously, for example, analysis, design, implementation, execution, they will have output. We have to collect all the output and consolidate the experiences. Not only the output, we also have to consolidate the experiences. What went wrong during the testing? What went good? Can we follow it in the next release? What we should avoid for the next release? All those things will be documented in the completion stage. And any other relevant information. So whatever relevant information we have with respect to the testing process, we have to document it during the test completion stage. So this is all about the test steps. Now let's see what are the different test activities or processes and the documents related to that. So during the planning stage, what we have, we will have the test plan. During monitoring stage, we will have the feedbacks. In the analysis stage, we will have the test conditions. In the test design stage, we have the high level test cases. During test implementation, we have the test scripts or low level test cases. And during test execution, we have to see that whether we have run all the test cases and we got all the results. I hope it is now clear. Please pause the video and please try to remember these terms, associated documents with the test process. It is important. Now let's summarize all the points which we have covered till now. First, we saw test analysis. During test analysis, the test basis is analyzed to identify testable features and define associated test conditions. And here we ask the question, what to test? Next stage is test design. During test design, the test conditions are elaborated into high level test cases, set of high level test cases and other test wares. And here we ask the question, how to test? Next is test implementation. During test implementation, the test wares necessary for the test execution is created and completed, including sequencing the test cases into the procedures. And here we ask, is everything ready to test? We take care that whatever is required for the test execution is done during the test implementation stage. Test execution. During test execution, test suits are run in accordance with the test execution schedule. Here we are just running the test cases. And then we compare the results over here. And the last stage is the test completion stage. The test completion activity collects the data from the completed test activities to consolidate experiences, testware, and any other relevant informations. So here we have to see that whether we have collected all the data and experiences or not. These three terms are very important, and what we should ask, that is also important, and their outputs are also important. So from next topic, from now on, what we will see each of these test activities in detail. What are the tasks which we are going to do under this activity is what we are going to see in the next slide.